four-wheel drive versus all-wheel drive. What's the diff? We'll convert Project Red Tide into all-wheel by sourcing parts to bring full-time power to every corner. And our 5.3 LS gets top-end goodies to bring the go. It's time for Truck Tech.
Today, we're going to be spending some quality time with Red Tide, our 88 Chevy 1500 four-wheel drive that's been lowered down to the ground. And we're going to be doing something that, to my knowledge, has never been done before in an old body style GMT 400 Chevy truck. Now, last time you guys saw Red Tide, we had yanked out the old TBI 350 and we replaced it with this 400 horse 5.3 liter LS engine and a 4L80E automatic trans. But it's just a bare engine and trans. There's no accessories, exhaust, intake, or wiring that we'll need to make it all run. And we'll take care of that in just a little bit. But first, we just got him some new drivetrain parts that I'm dying to show you. So just ignore this stuff over here for a minute. Our truck originally came equipped with an NP241 two-speed mechanical shift transfer case and, out front, a GM 8 1/4 inch independent front differential with a passenger side axle disconnect. Now, there's really no reason we can't reuse both of these parts. On the transfer case, all we'd have to do is take it apart and swap out the original 27-spline input shaft for a larger 32-spline input that'll work with the 4L80 transmission. It would only cost about $100 and take 30 minutes to take apart the transfer case and make the switch. Having a lowered four-wheel drive truck is cool, and a lot of guys who drag race simply shift into four-wheel drive at the line, make the pass and shift out of four-wheel drive at the end of the track. As long as you're driving in a straight line on pavement, the four-wheel drive system will work just fine, but you cannot use it driving around corners. Now that's fine if all you want to do is go drag racing, but we want to build something just a little bit different. Now, if you know of the Silverado SS that was made between 2003 and 2006, you'll remember that it was a full-time all-wheel drive truck, and it used a special transfer case with a viscous coupling inside that split the power 62% to the rear and 38% to the front. And we just found one. This is an NV149 transfer case we picked up from Powertrain Products, and it's been remanufactured with a new chain, bearings, and seals. Now, this was intended to be a replacement part for a later model truck, but it'll work perfectly to convert our old Chevy into a full-time all-wheel drive traction machine. Now, this will still work great at the drag strip for those launches, but you can still use it in everyday driving conditions as well, like snow, ice, dirt roads, or even just dry pavement, and you don't have to worry about switching into and out of four-wheel drive. The best part about the 149 case, though, is that it's a completely mechanical device, meaning there are no wires or control modules needed to make this work in our classic Chevy. One very important thing about running a full-time all-wheel drive transfer case has to do with the front differential. Both axle shafts have to be receiving power at all times. And if you remember, this differential has a disconnect on the passenger side, so that axle just spins freely. Now, there's a small fix for that if we want to use this axle. One solution would be to remove the thermal linear actuator and install this 4x4 permanent lock I picked up from Summit Racing. It pushes in on the shift fork, engaging the passenger side axle, and a pair of set screws hold it in place. This is an inexpensive way to get the job done. But sending a lot of power through a locked out axle shaft may not be the best long-term solution, especially on a vehicle that's going to spend a lot of time at highway speeds. Instead, I ordered a rebuilt front differential from Powertrain Products that fits the Silverado SS, certain Escalades, and Denalis. This one has a 410 gear ratio, which is going to be perfect for our truck. This has the updated pinion design to prevent the common failures, and since this is from an all-wheel drive application, it has the much stronger one-piece passenger side axle shaft. Now, the 88 to 98 trucks have a totally different frame than the 99 to 07 trucks that this differential was designed to fit. Now, honestly, when I ordered this, I had no idea if it would even work. But luckily, it's a much closer matchup than you might think.
Next, a little fab makes it fit.
The first step to converting Red Tide to all-wheel drive is getting the front differential mounted. And it's actually pretty remarkable how well this later model diff fits into this early year truck. In fact, both mounting points on the driver's side are in exactly the correct position. So the only thing we'll have to do there is come in and rebuild the lower mount tab that was cut off when the truck was lifted in its previous life. The flange to flange width of the axle is exactly the same as it was before, as are the mounting dimensions where the CV axle attaches. This is almost a bolt-in installation. In fact, the only thing that we're going to have to change is this mounting bracket on the passenger side, because the boss is cast in just a little bit different position. So all we need to do is build a new passenger side bracket, and we're in business. I'm using the old lifted diff mount as a donor for the bushing ends. A little work with a cutoff wheel frees them up. I'll clean the old welds and paint with a flat wheel. Now, I'll place the bushings back into the factory mounts on the frame. I'm notching some 1¾-inch tube to make the backbone of the mount. I made a template from cardboard, and it will transfer all the dimensions onto some 3/16 plate, which will include a line for a fold, and some notches to be cut out for the tube. Finally, it gets trimmed out on the bandsaw. Underneath the truck, the backbone goes onto the bushings, and our plate mount goes in. It's temporarily bolted onto the axle. With everything in position, I'll first tack weld the backbone to the bushing end, then the tab to the backbone. Now, I can remove it from the truck and add a gusset in the center. Then, finish weld the whole mount assembly. There are no off-the-shelf parts made for this swap, but it's just one of those situations where you have to get a little creative, use some fabrication tools, and you can build anything you need. It's these little steps that'll transform a run-of-the-mill build into something that's truly unique and one of a kind. With the front differential in its new home, the only thing we have left to do to convert this truck to all-wheel drive is install the transfer case. Now, these NV149s were only found behind 4L60s that had a 27-spline output shaft that keys in to the input of the transfer case. On most four-wheel drive transfer cases, that's not a big deal because there are some readily available factory parts like our 241, which came behind 4L80s in certain applications. The 149, though, never came behind a 4L80, so there are no readily available factory parts we could use to make the switch. There is, however, a company up in Michigan that custom manufactures shafts, and they built us a 32-spline input shaft that goes inside of our NV149. So all we got to do is take this thing apart, make the switch.
Next, transfer case tech.
Can be floating around up here and not picking up any oil. If that happens, we're opening up a brand new transfer case for Project Red Tide, and in the process, building a truck that's unlike any we've ever seen, making what we think will be the world's first all-wheel drive GMT 400 Chevy truck. To accomplish that, we need to install a different input shaft into this NV149. The rear bearing C-clip is disengaged through an access hole, and using a pair of pry bars, the glue sealing the two case halves together is cracked open, and the rear half of the case is removed. Now, the rear planetary and main shaft slide out, followed by the sprocket and chain.
Brand new chain. This guy right here, this is the viscous coupling. This is actually a non-serviceable item, but this is the part that makes the all-wheel drive magic happen. And that is our input shaft.
The last part holding the input shaft in is a C-clip, and once it's removed, a few gentle taps of the plastic dead blow frees it from the case. Finally, one more C-clip has to go, and the hammer helps remove the bearing. Now, the process gets reversed, with the bearing and C-clip going onto the 32-spline shaft.
I always want to take the time to make sure the snap rings are fully engaged in the slot, because if they're not, things could come apart and do a lot of damage. This guy's set. So back in it goes. You ready?
Yeah.
With a wooden block, the shaft and bearing are driven into the front case half.
Hear the sound change?
I think you're in.
That's how you know you're in.
The C-clip goes back in, followed by the viscous coupler. Then the chain and sprocket, and the main shaft and planetary slide back in. Then we'll clean any old sealant from the mating surface.
So probably the most important part about putting a transfer case back together is this guy right here, the oil pump pickup tube. Now, if you put this together incorrectly and the suction tube is not lined up with the sump, it can be floating around up here and not picking up any oil. If that happens, the transfer case, it'll still work, but it'll probably burn itself out. So always make sure the pickup tube is in the sump at the bottom of the case.
A little RTV is applied to seal up the case, and the rear half slides on, making sure to line up with the two internal shafts and the dowel pins. Now, the final C-clip is opened up, and the rear bearing is slid into place.
Right on the money.
It's a bit awkward, but the case gets maneuvered up between the two cross members. The shafts line up, and with a bit of wiggling, the trans and transfer case are united. A few bolts hold the whole package together, completing our all-wheel drive conversion.
Hey guys.
Hello.
Howdy. What's going on?
Last time I saw this truck, it was covered in mud and it had large tires on it. Now, it's totally changed. LS swap.
Yes.
And I don't know what kind of Kajavis is in this thing now for this. It all looks new. What's going on?
You've been busy for sure.
I've been a little bit busy, yeah. So we're trying to make something that's a little bit different, a little bit special. So we made an all-wheel drive truck, right? Something that they never made in this GMT 400 platform, right? So I robbed a bunch of parts from a later model truck, actually. Transfer case, that's from like the Silverado SS's, maybe the Escalades and Denalis. The front differential, this is probably my favorite part about this whole swap. This front diff, even though it's from a 99 to 07 truck, it actually, on this side, bolted right in. And the only thing I had to do, build a custom mount on the passenger side. But I mean, the axle to axle width was the same. The bolt pattern for the CVs was exactly the same, so.
You built this mount?
Yeah.
Really? That's awesome.
That's pretty impressive that the track width and all is dead on.
I think that's my favorite part about this whole thing is because I've had this idea for a while that I wanted to try to build an all-wheel drive truck. Yeah, really, I ordered that front diff entirely on a whim, not even knowing if it would fit, but it's so close, it's actually almost perfect.
Yeah, it's pretty neat that you went down this path. You know, I'm a big fan of the S10 trucks, and now it's full size, that's way cool.
I really like it. Now with the LS swap, you have a lot of potential to make more power because of all the parts that are available.
It all comes down to, you know, something you can use every day. So if you have a whole lot of power, you know, you drive it in the rain or the snow, you're just gonna be spinning out. So all-wheel drive, use it all the time, and just be different, I guess.
Oh, it's definitely different, but I like it, and I like it a lot, so good job.
All right, so you guys want to do any sanding and painting?
Yeah. He's pretty good at painting.
Yeah, painting. I could paint the block. That's about the extent of my talent, but that's
all right.
Other than that.
Speaking of paint, what about that blue transmission? That thing's
kind of electric.
Under here.
Very patriotic with the red truck.
Yeah.
Next, here come the power.
Our all-wheel drive conversion is done on this old body style Chevy. Now, I could spend some time out back and regear the 10 bolt to a 410 ratio that would match the new front axle that we just installed. But instead, I'm going to spend some time on this engine and see if we can get it a little bit closer to firing up. Because right now, this 5.3 is just a bare long block. All the important parts that it needs to fire up and run haven't been installed yet. Recently, I did some shopping and the delivery guy, well, he just dropped off a whole bunch of parts. I started out by going to Summit Racing and picking up a set of ceramic-coated long tube headers. Then I welded on some stainless steel 3-inch V-bands that'll connect to our exhaust later on. Then, for an intake manifold, I picked up this Holley Hi-Ram with a wrinkled black finish. Now, it looks great, but the long runner design is going to help make great low RPM torque. And if we ever decide to install a power adder, it's going to work great there as well. I also picked up a set of matching wrinkled black Holley valve covers, and Excel sent us some 61 pound per hour fuel injectors and some ceramic coated spark plug wires.
Then Summit sent us a few more odds and ends to complete the swap, like a water pump, starter, ignition coils, cam and crank sensor, and a dipstick. And it's all going to be controlled by this Holley Terminator LS multi-port injection setup. But we'll get started by installing the headers. These are a pace setter header designed to fit a 99 to 07 four-wheel drive Silverado. But luckily, they're a perfect fit for our LS swap truck. On the back of the block, the camshaft sensor slides in. And up front, the steam vent adapters attach to the cylinder head, which later get connected to the radiator to relieve pressure in the cooling system. Then, the front of the block is quickly prepped with a scuff pad, and the water pump gets bolted into place. We need to install an O-ring to seal the lid to the intake. It gets trimmed to length, and a couple dabs of RTV hold it in place. The lid goes on and gets bolted down. Now, all 8 injectors get lubed up and slid into the fuel rails. And the whole thing installs into the intake with just a little pressure. It all gets held in place with 2 bolts and spacers. Then each intake port gets an O-ring to seal it against the head. Back at the engine, the manifold slides right into place and nuts and washers hold it down. Now the stock valve covers get swapped for the taller black ones. The ignition coils go on and the plug wires are attached. The dipstick slides into the block and bolts to the head. Then the injector harness plugs in along with the coil harness. Finally, the crank sensor goes in, followed by the starter. Four-wheel drive independent front suspension systems have been used on a lot of pickups since sometime in the 1980s. Consumers started demanding pickups that were more and more comfortable, something they could use every day rather than those old school solid axles which just rode like a covered wagon. This is a GM 8 1/4 inch front differential that we pulled out of our 88K1500. And that's the first year GM used IFS on a full-size four-wheel drive truck. Now, a lot of people have no idea how these things work inside or what it takes to disassemble one. So today, we're going to take a closer look. But first, we'll do a comparison between an IFS front end and an old school solid axle. They're actually much more similar than you might think. Both have a ring gear inside and a pinion gear that's attached to a drive shaft coming from the transfer case. And both have a way to disconnect power from the wheels so you're not spinning the whole drive line when you're rolling down the road. On the old school axle, it's out here on the end of the hub. And on the IFS front end, it has an electronic disconnect mounted inside the axle. And that's where we're going to start our teardown. This is a thermal linear actuator, and it simply unscrews from the housing. Then a few bolts come out and the diff comes apart. Here we can see the passenger side two-piece axle disconnect system. This is what creates the link and power between the spinning wheel and the rest of the drivetrain. It's a cool combination between electronic and mechanical parts. This is how it works. As you apply 12 volts of power across the coil, the actuator heats up inside, expands, and pushes the rod out. Then when you remove power, it contracts back in. The actuator installs into the side of the housing, and as it expands, the end pushes out against a shift fork. There's a small dowel on the outside axle shaft that centers the inside, and as the shift fork extends, a collar slides over the splined areas of both part of the axles, engaging four-wheel drive. Then, when you disengage it, a spring pushes the shift fork back, releasing the collar. Finally, there's a small switch that tells the light on the dashboard when four-wheel drive is engaged. Disassembly continues with a few more bolts holding the main case halves together, and a pry bar opens them up. The CV flange on the driver's side is held in with an internal clip, so it takes a bit of force to pop out. From there, the carrier comes out, and it looks just like any other rear-wheel drive differential you're used to looking at. Now that you have the cases fully split, you can do several things. Put on new bearings to quiet down a noisy differential, reseal it to prevent a leak, or you can even re-gear because there are a lot of different aftermarket ratios available for the 8 1/4 front end. Now that you've taken it apart, it's real easy to put back together.
We've made great progress on this 5.3 today, and I have a few odds and ends left to install. I need to get the main wiring harness on for the fuel injection, find a place to mount the computer, get an accessory drive installed, a cooling system, and a fuel system. But the all-wheel drive conversion is a success. The only thing I have left to finish up on the drivetrain is the rear axle, which needs to be re-geared to match the front. If you want any more information on any of the projects we build on this show, be sure to check out PowerNationTV.com. Thanks for watching Truck Tech, and we'll see you next time.